So this is to give you a brief account on the muscles of facial expression as we find them on plastinated models. Here we have the frontalis part of occipitofrontalis. This is a muscle of the scalp. This is the frontalis part. Here's the epicranial aponeurosis. And here you can see the occipitalis part, which is attached to the occipital bone posteriorly. Frontalis constitutes the dilator mechanism of the eye, and the sphincter mechanism here, the muscle, which constitutes a sphincter for the eye, and this is the orbicularis oculi muscle. And this muscle is in two parts. It has the orbital part, the big part here, and the palpebral part. The palpebral part is located within the lids, upper eyelid and lower eyelid. These few slips of muscle fibers here, they belong to Procerus muscle. The corrugator supercilii is not shown here because the corrugator supercilii is a deep muscle located at this position, but it is deep, deep to orbicularis oculi muscle and deep to frontalis of occipitofrontalis. Here we can see also some of the muscles that act on the nose. This is the levator labii superioris aliquenesi. A few slips of them are shown here. And also you can see some of the dilator mechanism of the mouth. So this is the levator labii superioris, some slips of zygomaticus minor muscle. See, the zygomaticus minor is smaller and more medial to the laterally located and bigger zygomaticus major muscle. And zygomaticus major muscle is attached to lateral to the angle of the mouth, to the region of the modiolus here. The deep muscle that is shown here is levator labii superioris muscle. All these are, they constitute a dilator mechanism. The sphincter mechanism is shown here. It's a muscle of the lip. This is the orbicularis oris muscle. You can see the concentric fibers of the muscle. On the chin, note that you see that this muscle, this is the depressor anguli oris, and then the depressor labii inferioris muscle. These are also belonging to the dilator mechanism. Mentalis muscle is not very clear here, but this is the position of mentalis muscle. It's a deep muscle located medially. Of the other structures that we can see here on the face, this is the facial artery. See the tortuous course of this artery. It's located anterior to the facial vein. And the artery crosses the inferior border of the mandible in front of this muscle. This muscle is located in the face. It's the masseter muscle, but it's not a muscle of facial expression. It moves the mandible, and it's a muscle of mastication, not a muscle of facial expression. You can see here that it is crossed by the duct of the parotid gland. And this is the parotid gland here, and the duct passes horizontally in the face, just inferior to the zygomatic arch, and pierces the buccinator. Buccinator is a muscle of facial expression, but it's located deeply. We are not much concerned about it in Botox injections. The duct of the parotid gland passes through buccinator and opens into the mouth. The buccinator muscle is the muscle of the cheek, and sometimes it's considered as an accessory muscle of mastication. Of the other structures that we can see on the face are these nerve fibers. These are motor nerve fibers. They are branches, most of them are branches of the facial nerve. The facial nerve passes through the substance of the parotid gland, and then from the anterior surface of the parotid, it provides five groups of branches, not necessarily branches, but five groups of branches. So we have the temporal, we have the zygomatic branches, the buccal branches, and this is called the marginal mandibular or mandibular branches. They supply the muscles of the lower lip. The buccal branches supply the muscles of the upper lip and the buccinator. Zygomatic branches, they supply orbicularis oculi muscle, and the temporal branches, they supply the frontalis of occipitofrontalis. The fifth group of branches, or the fifth branch, is this one, and this is called the cervical branch. It descends downwards into the neck and supplies the platysma muscle. The platysma muscle is not shown here, but but it's a superficial muscle in the neck located just beneath the skin and considered as another muscle of facial expression. Of the other structures that we can see here at the upper border of parotid gland are these vessels. These are the superficial temporal vessels, branches of the external carotid artery, and the auriculotemporal nerve. In fact, the auriculotemporal nerve is a sensory branch, and it supplies sensation to the temple here. So this is another specimen, probably to show us some of the muscles that were not seen in the previous one, like this muscle. This is the corrugator supercilii muscle here. See, it's attached to the glabellar line and passes upwards and laterally to be attached to the upper lid. It's a deep muscle and can only be seen after the orbital part of orbicularis oculi and frontalis muscle are removed. And this muscle is responsible, together with the procerus muscle, this procerus muscle, together they are responsible for the formation of lines in between the eyebrows. So this muscle is responsible, the corrugator supercilia is responsible for the formation of glabellar lines, vertical glabellar lines, while the procerus muscle is responsible for horizontal glabellar lines at the root of the nose. Keep in mind that injections here into the corrugator supercilii should be deep injection, because the muscle is actually deep. Sometimes overactivity of this muscle, the orbicularis oculi, might result in ptosis of the lid, and this will be accompanied by a compensatory mechanism for contraction of frontalis muscle, and in this case, the part of the muscle is weakened by an injection here at the upper lateral part of the muscle. This is what we call a lateral brow lift. Injections here around the orbit should be away from the orbital margin, about 1 centimeter away from the orbital margin, because injections here, if they are close to the upper part of the orbital margin, then they might affect the muscle of the eyelid, the upper eyelid, the elevator of the upper eyelid, which is not shown here, is levator palpebrae superioris muscle, and this will cause drooping of the upper eyelid, ptosis. On the lateral side, injections that are given to ameliorate the crowfoot, they should also be given away from the lateral canthus of the eye, because sometimes the injection, if it passes into the eye, into the orbit, it might affect the lateral rectus muscle, which is located inside, and this might result in a squint. The other muscle that we see here, only a few slips of the muscle can be seen here. It's a few slips of the muscle. This is the compressor nairs muscle. And this muscle is responsible for the bunny lines. You can see that at the midline, there is an aponeurosis. The muscle is located laterally. We should be careful while injecting this muscle not to include these muscle fiber slips. These belong to levator labii superioris elecnesi. And if these muscle slips are involved by the injection, by the Botox injection, then this might affect the upper lip as well. So the injection should be restricted to the area medial to levator labii superioris elecnesi muscle. Also, we can see the muscles of the lip. This is the orbicularis oris muscle. And look at the concentric fibers of orbicularis oris muscle. This is the region of the modiolus. And here, this is the buccinator muscle. We are not much concerned about the buccinator muscle. It's the muscle of the cheek. We are probably here more concerned about these muscles. This is the depressor anguli oris muscle, depressor labii inferioris muscle, and again, not very clear, this is the region of mentalis muscle. This muscle, levator anguli oris muscle, is responsible for the marionette lines, and injections should be given into this muscle away from the lip margin, because if it is involved the lip margin, it will affect the sphincter mechanism of the lip, and this will not only result in deformed look, but it also might affect the speech. It might affect eating and drinking and result in drooling from the mouth. This is to give you another look of the depressor anguli oris muscle and depressor labii inferioris muscle. These are the horizontal and concentric muscle fibers of orbicularis oris muscle. And here, this is the region of the modiolus where there is an exchange and interchange of fibers of the muscles of the dilator and the sphincter mechanism of the mouth. It's about 1 centimeter from the lateral angle of the mouth. Now back to the previous specimen. The muscles of the upper lip, the dilator mechanism of the upper lip, including the levator labii superioris elecnesi, levator labii superioris zygomaticus minor and zygomaticus major, these muscles are usually injected when there's a muscular factor causing the gummy smile. And so the injection is given along the nasolabial fold. Levator labii superioris muscle, in fact, is the main muscle that is responsible for deepening of this nasolabial fold.